ओके, कम टू पेपर थ्री ऑफ जेई मेंस फिजिक्स. लेट अस डिस्कस द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन. द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन सेज दैट इन हाइड्रोजन एटम, एक्साइटेड हाइड्रोजन एटम, द फर्स्ट एमिशन कोरस्पॉन्ड्स टू द लॉन्गेस्ट वेवलेंथ ऑफ पास्टन सीरीज. मीन्स द एटम वॉज ऑलरेडी एक्साइटेड एंड when electron jumps to the next state, it is giving the Pastian series. So longest wavelength of Pastian series means the wavelength arriving here, Lehmann, here the if electron falls here, it is Balmer, and here if electron falls on third orbit, it is Pastian. So longest wavelength means the minimum energy corresponding to the electron falling on this orbit. So we will have electrons from 4 to 3, which is given in the problem, that is longest wavelength of Pastian series. After this, it is asked that what are the out of these 4 options which will not include in this further emissions, out of these 4 options which will not be there in the further emission. So let us see, if electron has reached here, if it will jump to next state, we will get Balmer series with longest wavelength, because the energy gap between 3 and 2, the orbit number 3 and 2 will give the Balmer series with least energy or longest wavelength. So Balmer series with longest wavelength will be emitted. Next, the electron may jump from second to first orbit. So jumping to first orbit means it is Lehmann series and longest, the minimum energy here, so longest wavelength. So Lehmann series with longest wavelength, it will also be emitted. Now electron could jump directly from third orbit to first orbit. In this case also Lehmann series will be there, but this is second longest Lehmann series, because the energy gap is not minimum but it is second minimum. So we will have also second longest Lehmann series, and finally we are not having this one, second longest Balmer series we are not getting. So our answer will be option D. Okay, come to next question. Question number 2. In this question we are having a block of mass 2m and there is another mass of m kept on it. The second mass is A and first mass is B of value 2m. Now friction coefficients are given, between A and B is mu and between B and ground is also mu. If whole system is moving with velocity v, it is given velocity v in rightward direction, then we have to find the acceleration of A with respect to B. So in this case what we are going to do, first the normal reaction here on A is N1, and N1 value will be mg, and normal reaction at B from the ground will be due to weight of both. The normal reaction at ground will be due to weight of both, so that will be 2mg plus mg, that will be 3mg. Now we will write accelerations of these two objects separately. So first, since they are moving in rightward direction, the friction force will act on this object in leftward direction. So friction force will act on this object in leftward direction, and since the object B will get slowed down because of this friction, this object will also try to slow down the object A. So object A will be also pulled back by a friction force by B. Suppose this is F1 and here it is F2. The block B due to ground will be pulled back due to friction, and block A will be pulled back due to block B, and B will try to pull the A will try to pull block B in forward direction. So these two are Newton's third law force pair, F1 and F1. So now we will write for block B. For block B, we can write acceleration of B equal to F2 minus F1 divided by 2m, and its value will be F2 will be mu into N2 minus mu into N1 by 2m. Now putting the value of N2 and N1, we are going to get, here we will get mu into N2 is 3mg minus 3n1 is mg by 2m. So we will get for acceleration of block B, you get 2 mu 2mg by 2m. So we will get mu g. Similarly for block A, we are going to write F1 by mu, F1 by m, and value of F1 is mu mg by m, and we will get mu g. Since both are having same acceleration, A and B are having same acceleration, the acceleration of A with respect to B or B with respect to A will be 0. So we can write the option A here. Okay, come to next question number 3. In this question, we have been given a block which is sliding on an incline of inclination theta, and the coefficient of friction between the block and the incline is mu. And it is asked that force exerted by block on the incline, the magnitude of force exerted by block on the incline. So for this, what we are going to do, we will write all the forces. So on this block, we are having two forces. One is normal and second is friction. Since block is sliding down, the friction will act at its maximum value. So we can write normal in this case is mg cos theta, and friction will acquire the normal value, that will be mu into n, and mu mg cos theta. Since these two are perpendicular to each other, we can write net force as n square plus f square under root. Since these two are perpendicular to each other, the net resultant force of these two can be calculated like this, and we can write finally mg cos theta plus mu mg cos theta square. So we will get mg cos theta mu square plus 1. So this is the value exerted by incline on the object, and the same amount of force will be exerted by the object on the incline. So our option will be B. Okay, come to question number 4. In this question, it is given that there is a long cylinder which is maintained between two different temperatures T1 and T2, and it has been asked that out of these four quantities, which will be same throughout: pressure, density, ratio of pressure to density, number of molecules per unit volume. So first let us see, we will try to write PV equal to nRT in terms of density and pressure. So we will get density RT by molecular weight M. So pressure equal to density into RT by molecular weight. Now let us see which quantities will vary in this cylinder. So if we have quantities varying in the cylinder, if we have different pressure at different places, the molecules try to adjust the difference in pressure very fast because of their very high velocity. So we cannot have different pressures at different places. Different pressure will lead to very fast movement and adjustment of pressure, movement of molecules and adjustment of pressure. So we cannot have different pressures at different points. So our constant quantity will be pressure. Now we can check whether density is same or not. If pressure is same, since temperature is changing, density will also change because R and M both are constant. So density is variable. Ratio of P by rho. Ratio of P by rho, that will be P by rho RT by M. Since P by rho is RT by M and T is variable, so we will also the quantity P by rho will also vary. Similarly, number of molecules per unit volume. Number of molecules per unit volume is proportional to density. So if density is varying, the number of molecules per unit volume will also vary. So only quantity which is constant is pressure, and so we will write our option as A. Okay, come to next question, question number 5. In this question we have been given a circuit and point A and B are given. We have to find potential difference between A and B. So for this, what we are going to do, we will start from point A, VA, and we will keep on writing the potential drop or potential rise throughout the circuit while moving from A to B. We will start from A and we will keep on moving towards B, and we will keep on writing the change in potential through each segment. So starting with A, from here to here, there will be a potential rise of 12 volt because polarity is plus this side and minus this side. So if we move from here to here, we will have VA plus 12 volt at this point. Now if we move from this point to this point, since current is flowing like this, 2 ampere, current is flowing rightward 2 ampere. So there will be a drop of potential in the direction of current. There is a drop of potential. So we will write minus 2 ampere into 2 ohm. Now after this point, from here to here, there is a drop of potential 6 volt. There is a drop of potential 6 volt because we are going from plus side to minus side. So minus 6 volt. Now from here to here, since current is in opposite direction, we are moving opposite to the current, we will have rise of potential in this case, and we can add plus 1 ohm into current through this segment is 3 ampere. And finally we have reached to point B, so it will be equal to VB. Now we can write VA minus VB equal to, these values if we solve, minus 12 plus 4 plus 6 and minus 3. So we are going to get minus 5 volt. So our answer will be option C. Okay, come to the next question, question number 6. In this question we have been given a square plate and we have a line which is passing through center of mass and parallel to the sides and in the plane of plate AB, we are having moment of inertia about AB is I. There is another line CD which is also passing through center of mass and in the plane of plate, but CD is making angle theta with AB, and given theta is between 0 to 90 degree. We have to find the moment of inertia about CD. So for this, what we can do? We can use the perpendicular axis theorem. If moment of inertia about AB is I, we can draw a perpendicular line here. Suppose this is A dash, B dash. Since A dash, B dash and AB are similar lines, they are symmetrical. So what we can write? Moment of inertia from perpendicular axis theorem. The moment of inertia about an axis passing through point O and perpendicular to plane IO, I am writing IO, the moment of inertia about an axis perpendicular to the plane of sheet and passing through center of mass IO, this will be IAB plus IA dash B dash, and IAB is given I, and IA dash B dash will have same value as IAB because these two lines are similar. So we will get 2i. Now we can apply the same perpendicular axis theorem for two lines CB and CD, C dash D dash. CD and C dash D dash. These two are perpendicular to each other, and this C dash D dash and CD are also symmetrical lines. We can see here it is making an angle theta, CD is making angle theta with the AB, and here C dash D dash is also making angle theta with AB. So these two are symmetrical lines. So we can also write I naught equal to I CB I C dash I CD and I C dash D dash. So we will get, since these two are equal, they are similar lines, we can write ICD or ICD equal to I naught by 2, and value of I naught we had calculated 2i. So finally I. So what we are getting, the moment of inertia about CD is same as moment of inertia about AB. Value is I. So our option will be A. Okay, come to the next question, question number C. In this question we have been given a wire, straight wire of length L, mass M. The wire is in horizontal direction and it is kept in a magnetic field in vertical direction. The magnetic field is in vertical direction. If charge Q flows through the wire, then what will be the velocity gained by wire? If charge Q flows suddenly from the wire, then what will be the velocity gained by wire? So for this, first we will write the expression for force. So the force will be I current through the wire into length of wire into B sin theta, where theta is angle between length of wire and magnetic field, which is in this case 90 degree. The length and magnetic field is making 90 degree. So we will write I L B sin 90 equal to I L B. Now we have to find velocity. So for that, first we will try to find the impulse given by this force to the wire. So impulse J will be F dt, and I L B dt L and B are constant and I dt will give the charge. So we will get impulse imparted to this wire as LB into Q, and impulse will be equal to the change in momentum, and initially wire was at rest, so change in momentum will be MV, and that will be LBQ. So V will be LBQ by M, and our answer will be option C. We come to next question, question number 8. In this question we have been given a long straight current carrying conductor and an electron is ejected from its surface. So what will be its motion? There are four options given and about the motion of electron and how it will move. So the options are, first option is the electron will return to the wire itself. Then the options are whether electron will move in a helical path around the wire. Then option is it will move in a spiral path, move away from the wire, or it will move in a circular path. So let us see what will happen. First, if electron is ejected, suppose in this direction, and magnetic field due to wire will be like this, into the plane and here out the plane. Electron is ejected. So we will get force on the electron. Suppose electron is going like this, so QV cross B. So from plus charge it will be upward, or minus charge it will be downward. So electron will bend like this. But as electron is moving forward, the value of magnetic field is decreasing. The value of magnetic field will be large at this point and less at this point. So electron will not go in circular motion, because magnetic field is not constant. The radius of curvature of electron will change at every moment. It will not be in a circle, but finally it will bend like this. At some point it will bend, and it is not losing any energy in the magnetic field. In magnetic field cannot do any work on electrons, so it is not going to lose any energy. So finally it will return to it will return to the wire itself. So what we will get, the one of the option is option A, in which it is written that electron will return to the same place. So our option will be A. We come to next question, question number 9. In this question we have been given, due to certain charge distribution we have potential in this place, and all the zero potential point can be joined by a circle called S. Inside the circle all points have positive potential, outside the circle all points have negative potential. So we have to select out of these four options for a positive charge. If positive charge is released from inside, what will happen to this positive charge? So first option is it must remain at rest. So it may not be that it must remain at rest. It may remain or may not remain, depending upon how potential is distributed inside. Because the object will remain at rest or not, it depends upon the field. And field is given by rate of change of potential. So by finding rate of change of potential, we can say anything about the whether charge will move or not. So must word we should not use. Second is can move inside B but cannot cross S. This is also wrong, because object may also cross this boundary. There is no restriction why the object cannot cross. If field at this point will be in outward direction, the object will surely cross the S. May cross S. So this is wrong, this is correct. So object may cross S. Fourth point is may move but ultimately return to starting point. It may not be necessary. object may move outside and may not return to the same point because we may have field in outward direction. So object will finally go outside. So our correct answer will be C, option C. Okay, come to next question, question number 10. In this question we have been given a string fixed between two points, and length of a string, mass of a string and tension is given, and a pulse is created in the string, and it is asked that after how much time the string will have same shape. The at time t1 and at time t2, if they are having same shape, then what will be the minimum value of t2 minus t1? So we have to find after how much time the string will have same shape. Since pulse is moving, initially suppose it is like this, after some time the shape will be like this, and after some more time the shape will be like this, and finally it will get reflected, and if a wave is reflected from fixed end, it will get inverted, then it will move backward, it will go like this and then move backward, then again it will get reflected, and after second reflection it will become erect, and after some time it may reach, or it will reach to the same position. So the pulse has reached to the same position. For arriving to same position, the pulse has to travel a total distance 2L. L for going forward and L for coming backward. It has to total travel distance 2L. So our answer will be the total distance traveled by the velocity. So what we have to write? Total distance travel, that is 2L by velocity, which we will write under root T by mu, where T is tension and mu is mass per unit length. So 2L by T, and it will be M by L. And finally we are going to get 2, here we will get T, here we will get M, and this L will go here, and finally it will cancel below the L, so we will get this much, and if we put the values, we will get M equal to 0.01. If you put these values, I will write here, put these values, we are going to get 2 into M is 0.01, L is 0.4, and divided by tension is 1.6. So if we solve it, finally we will get answer as 0.1 second, which is option B. Okay, come to next question, question number 11. In this question we have a ring in horizontal plane and we have a magnetic field in cylindrical region along vertical direction, and magnetic field is as shown in diagram. The center of magnetic field is, or axis of magnetic field is coinciding with the axis of ring. Now if all of a sudden the magnetic field is switched off, what will be the angular velocity attained by the ring? And mass of ring is given and charge on the ring is given. So for this, first we need to find the field at the ring. So for this what we will do, we will use Faraday's law, EdL. Suppose field here is E, and if we integrate this over whole length, we are going to get the total EMF that will be d phi by dt, will get d phi by dt, and flux is due to this region, the magnetic field B. So we can write minus d phi will be pi a square into dB by dt. Now if we integrate this side, we can consider electric field at all points to be having same value. Since all points are equidistant from the center, we can consider the electric field to be same, and if we can take it outside, after taking dot product we get 2 pi capital R, since dl is here, and if we integrate for whole length we will get 2 pi capital R minus pi a square dB by dt. So electric field is a square by 2r dB by dt. Now electric field at this point we have got. For this after this, what we are going to do, we will find the force by this electric field on the charge on the ring. So force we can write as E into dQ, force on a small part of wire. Now this force we will convert into torque. So torque we can write as, since force is acting at a distance r, the torque will be r d f, or we can write integration of r E dQ. Now the torque we will convert into the angular impulse. We will try to convert the torque into in terms of angular impulse. So for this, what we will do is tau dt, that is angular impulse, we will write this as, we will put value of torque here. So integration of r e dq into dt. Now we'll put all these values, r e dq. So r is radius, value of e was two r dB by dt into dq. Since all these quantities are constant, we can take it integration sign. Finally we can write r cancel, so we can write a square by 2 dB by dt into q into dt. Now this is the angular impulse imparted to the ring. Now we can solve it further, a square by 2 into q, dt will get cancelled, which we can write a square q b by 2. This we are getting as angular impulse, and angular impulse can also be written as I into omega. The angular impulse, since initially the ring was at rest, the angular impulse can be written as change in angular momentum, which will be I omega a square q b by 2. So omega will be a square q b by 2 i, where I for ring will be m r square. So we can write our answer as a square q b by 2 m r square, and that is option A. Okay, come to question number 12. In this question we have been given a flywheel which rotates and it experiences a retarding torque, and the retardation is proportional to the angular velocity. So we can write the equation like alpha equal to minus k is proportionality constant and minus sign is for retardation. And it is said that if it makes n rotations, for n rotations, the velocity, angular velocity reduces to half. Omega reduces to 2/2, or initial velocity suppose omega naught, then it reduces to omega naught by 2. And it is asked that after how many more rotations it will finally come to rest. So for first part it is given for n rotations omega naught initial velocity reduces to omega naught by 2, and second part it is asked omega naught to 0, how many rotations it will make. So for that we will try to solve the equation. Alpha is d omega by tt minus k omega. For solving this we will multiply d theta here and d theta here. D theta by dt can be written as omega d omega minus k omega d theta. Omega will cancel on the both sides, so d omega will be equal to k d theta. After integration we'll get omega minus k theta plus integration constant, and integration constant we can find by using initially when there was no rotation, the angle rotated was zero, at that time omega was omega naught. So omega naught equal to 0 plus c, or c equal to omega naught. Final equation we can write as omega equal to minus k theta plus omega naught. This is the equation. Now what we will do, we will come to the conditions equation given in the question. The first part says for n rotations omega becomes to omega naught becomes to omega naught by 2. So what we will write, omega naught by 2 minus k theta, it makes n rotations while coming from omega naught to omega naught by 2. So for n rotations theta will be 2 pi into n and omega naught. This is first case. And in second case the question has been asked, if its velocity reduces to omega naught by 2, then how much time it will take. So that we can write as how much rotations it will make. So that we can write as final velocity as 0, and suppose it makes n dash rotation, so we can write 2 pi n dash. And here initial velocity for the second part, for second part initial velocity is omega naught by 2. For second part initial velocity is omega naught by 2. Now we have to compare these two equations. So for comparing what we will do, we have to find n dash. So it is better to replace k, because k is not given in the question. So we can replace k, the value of k will be omega naught by 2 to 2 pi n dash, and we will put in the first equation. So we will get omega naught by 2 minus, at place of k we will write omega naught by 2 into 2 pi n dash, and here 2 pi n plus omega naught. So we can solve this and we will get this to cancelled. Omega naught will also get cancelled. Half minus n by 2 n dash plus 1. If we solve it, we are going to get n equal to n dash, or n dash equal to n. So our final answer will be n rotations, and that is option B. We come to the next question, question number 13. In this question, we have a beam of mass m, length l, kept in horizontal direction and supported by two pillars. And it is asked that if right pillar is removed, then what will be the reaction forces here? And there are four options given about the reaction forces at this point, and about one option is also about the acceleration of center of mass. First, let us see that what will be the reaction force. So since these two are symmetrical, total weight of this object will be mg. So reaction force will be equal at these two points. Here it will be mg by 2, and here also it will be mg by 2. At both supports, the reaction force will be initially mg by 2. Now, if this beam is, this pillar is removed, if this pillar is removed, what will be the new reaction force? We are going to calculate that. So for that, first we will calculate the angular acceleration and acceleration. New reaction force we are writing as R. Here it is mg. So we can write the equation for rotation about the contact point between these two. So torque equation about, suppose this point is called A, about A will be equal to, there is only one torque due to mg. Reaction force will not produce any torque because reaction force is at the point A itself, only mg will produce the torque. So we will write mg acting at a distance L by 2, this is total torque, will be equal to I into alpha, torque equal to I alpha, that we have written here. And value of I about the end point for a rod, we can write m L square by 3 into alpha. So alpha we will get 3 g by L. After solving, we will get alpha equal to 3g by L. Now, we will calculate the acceleration. Acceleration we can calculate mg downward minus reaction force upward. The new reaction force will be ma of center of mass of rod. Mg downward and reaction force upward equal to mass into acceleration of center of mass. So R we can write as mg minus m and acceleration of center of mass. Now we will try to find the acceleration of center of mass. So center of mass is here. We have got angular acceleration. So acceleration of center of mass can be written with respect to this point. We can write, since this point is at rest and angular acceleration is alpha, and distance of the center from A is L by 2. So we can write mg minus m, center of mass acceleration will be alpha into this distance, because object is rotating about point O. So we will write alpha into L by 2. We will get
एम जी माइनस एम थ्री जी बाई एल
टू एल बाई टू. Here it is 2, so we will get finally 3 by 4 and R will be mg by 4. So we have got value of R as mg by 4. Initially it was mg by 2. So value of reaction force at point A has reduced to half, and that is given in option B. So we will write our answer as option B.
Okay, come to next question, question number 14. In this question we have been given two containers of equal volume and same gas is kept in the two containers. Pressure is given P naught and temperature T naught in both, and they are joined by a thin pipe. Now one of the container is heated to temperature 2 T naught, from T naught to 2 T naught, and it has been asked what will be the new pressure. So for finding this, what we are going to do, since total number of molecules will remain conserved in both the containers, we can use that. So PV equal to nRT. In first container, initially the molecules will be P naught, if volume is V for both, P naught V by R T naught in first one, and in second one, since they were at same condition initially, in second one also we will have same amount of moles. So P naught V by R T naught into 2, this is initial number of moles, initial moles, and it will be equal to final number of moles, and final we can write as first part is at T naught temperature, second is at 2 T naught. So we will write separately P naught, new pressure is supposed P V by R, and temperature for first part is T naught. This is number of moles in the first part after heating the container. Now in the second container, since pressure will be same, because if there is a difference of pressure, the gases will move and they will adjust the pressure. Pressure will be same. So P, volume is V, R, now temperature is 2 T naught, because second one was heated. Now if we solve this, we are going to get two T naught equal to T naught equal to P plus P by 2. So P will be 4 T naught by 3, and that is option B. Okay, come to question number 15. In this question we have been given three rings and they are touching each other. Mass of each ring is M and radius is R. We have an axis shown like this passing through center of one of the ring, and here it is passing through contact between two rings. We have to find moment of inertia about this axis for the whole system. So first we will write, suppose this is 1, this is moment of inertia 2, and for this one it is 3. For 1, the moment of inertia about a point passing through center of mass and perpendicular to the ring is mr square, and along the diameter, if we have an axis along the diameter, we write moment of inertia of ring is mr square by 2. Similarly, for I2, if you want to write the value of I2, we will use parallaxis theorem. First, about its center of mass, means about its diameter, the moment of inertia will be mr square by 2, and then we will do m into this distance between two axes, the axis about which we have to find moment of inertia and the axis passing through center of mass is r. So we will write mr square. So we will get 3 by 2 mr square. The calculation which we have done for I2, the same calculation will be applicable for I3 because it is symmetrical. So I3 will also be 3 by 2 mr square. Now the net moment of inertia, if we sum I1 plus I2 plus I3, we are going to get 7 by 2 mr square, and that is option C. Come to next question, question number 16. In this question we have been given a gas with degree of freedom 6 expands isobarically and it performs a work 25 joule, and we have to find the heat absorbed by gas. For this, heat absorbed is nCp dT. Heat absorbed by gas can be given by nCp dT, where Cp is specific heat at constant pressure. Because gas is expanding isobarically, that's why we have written Cp. Now, work is given. So at constant pressure, work is can be written as PdV, which can be written as nR dT. Since PV equal to nRT, after differentiation P is constant, PdV can be written as nR dT, or P delta V is nR delta T. Now which we can use here, nR delta T. Now in this equation, QCP at place of n delta T, we will use from the second equation. This is first equation and this is second equation. From second equation, we will put the value of n delta T. That will be W by R. The value of n delta T from the second equation, we can write, it is better to write W by R, and we can put W by R here. The value of Cp for a gas at for degree of freedom 6, we will write Cp is F into F plus 2 by 2 into R into W by R. So this is the expression for Cp for a gas having degree of freedom F. Now we can put the values. Degree of freedom is 6. So 6 plus 2 by 2, R will get cancelled to W. So it will be 4 into W, 4 times W. And the value of W is 25. So we will get 100. And that 100 is in option B. So our answer will be B. Come to question number 70. In this question, we have a chain which is kept on table, and 1/4 of the chain is hanging from the side. And it has been asked how much work has to be done to pull back the whole chain on the table. So for this, we will use the conservation of energy. the amount of work which has to be done will be equal to the change of potential energy. So how much potential energy will change? First we will calculate that. So change of potential energy, the mass of this hanging part is m by 4, because only 1/4 of chain is hanging, and g into h, the height h we will take. And what value we should take for h? Since chain is uniform from here to here, from distance 0 to l by 4, but center of chain is lying at a distance l by 8. The center of mass is at l by 8. So if whole chain is lifted, the center of mass will lift only by l by 8. So we will write m by 4 into g, at place of h will have l by 8. So m g l by 32. This is change in potential energy of chain, and same will be the work done required . So our answer will be MgL by 32, and that is option D. Okay, come to next question, question number 18. In this question we have been given a rectangular block, which is a block which is floating in water of density rho. Mass of block is M, and the cross section area is A. Now if it is disturbed from its position in vertical direction slightly, what will be the time period of oscillation? So suppose it is pressed downward by an amount x, then we will try to find what are the different unbalanced forces acting on it. Initially the block was floating, so there was no unbalanced force. It was not moving in upward or downward direction. So there was no unbalanced force on this block. Now it is pressed downward. We will try to find the unbalanced force. And the unbalanced force will come from the buoyancy. So if it is pressed by x, the extra amount of volume replaced will be A into x. Since A is cross-section area and it is displaced by x, the extra amount of volume displaced will be A into x, the volume into density of liquid will give the mass of liquid displaced, the mass of liquid displaced into g will give the weight of liquid displaced, and this is the unbalanced force. The weight of liquid replaced, the extra liquid replaced will give the unbalanced force. So this is the unbalanced force, and we will write minus sign here because this force is of restoring nature. If the object is pushed downward, the force is acting upward. So we are writing minus sign here, and F can be written as mass of block into acceleration of block A rho g into x. Now acceleration is minus A rho g by m into x. So we can see acceleration is proportional to displacement with proportionality constant A rho g by m, which is square of omega. From here we can find time period 2 pi under root m by A rho g. So our answer will be option B. Come to question number 19. In this question we have been given a pipe which is closed at one end and open at other end. Length of pipe is 1 meter. Velocity of sound is given 300 meter per second. And it has been asked, out of these four frequencies, at which frequency the tube will not resonate. For solving this question, we will write the frequency for normal mode of vibration or resonating frequency. For one enclosed, we can write V by 4L into N plus half, where N is integer. If we want to write different values of frequency, we can write V by 4L, 3V by 4L, 5V by 4L, like this we can write different frequencies. Now let us check one of the frequency. Velocity is 300 by 4 and L. L is 1 meter, so we will get 75. Now first frequency is 75 Hertz. Second frequency is 3 times of first one. Third frequency is 5 times of first one. Means we are getting frequency which are all are odd multiples of the minimum frequency 75. So possible frequencies will be 225. Now this is multiplied with 3 times. When the fundamental frequency is multiplied 5 times, we will get 375 and so on. So this is possible, and this is also possible. The 300 Hertz is not coming in this series. 300 Hertz is even multiple of 75. So our answer will be this one. The question was asked which one is not resonate with the tube. So we will write C. Okay, come to question number 20. In this question it is given that uranium 238 is decaying by N1 alpha decay and N2 beta decay to lead 206. Now what is the value of N1 and N2? So first we can consider alpha decay, because beta decay does not include mass. So alpha decay can be calculated very easily by calculating change of mass. So change of mass is 238 minus 206. Change of mass number from uranium to lead is 238 to 206, and per alpha particle the mass associated is 4 units. So number of alpha particles or number of alpha decays will be calculated like this, and we can get 32 by 4, which is 8. So N1 is 8. Now if N1 alpha decay is occurring from uranium, its charges will also decrease. The decrease of charge will be 92 minus per alpha particle, the decrease of charge is 2 units. So 92 minus 2 units, and 8 alpha particles are emitted. So final charge of uranium after only alpha decay will be 92 minus 2 times of 8 alpha decays. Now final is 82. So final is 82. This value we are getting only after alpha decay. Now after beta decay we have increase of 1 charge per beta decay. So suppose we have N2 beta decay, so we can write plus N2 here. Because of alpha decay we will have decrease in the charge, that is 2 into 8 times 16 units decrease, and then we will have increase in charge, that is N2. The N2 number of increase in charge will be N2, because N2 is beta decay. So the value of N2 we are going to get is 82 minus 92 plus 16, which is 6. So N1 is 8 and N2 is 6, and which is option C. We come to question number 21. In this question it has been given that while transmitting a signal with the help of carrier wave, the carrier wave peak voltage is 12 volt and modulating index is 75%, and it has been asked what will be the peak voltage of modulating signal. So what we will write, modulating the modulation index we will write as M equal to E, the peak voltage of modulating signal, divided by peak voltage of carrier wave. Here it is 75%, it is given in the question, and we have to find the value of modulating signal. So EM and EC, the peak voltage of carrier wave is given 12 volt, so EM will be 12 into 75%, that is 9 volt, and this is our option A. Come to next question, question number 22. This question is about transistor. In this question it is given, in common emitter configuration the voltage across a resistance, the voltage across a resistance is 0.5 volt and the resistance is 500 ohm, and it is also given in common base mode the current gain is 0.96, and we have to find the base current. So first what we will try to do, we will find the collector current, because this voltage is across collector and this load is connected to collector. So collector current will be VC by VL, that will be 0.5 by 500, so which we can write as 1 milliampere. So current through collector is IC is 1 milliampere. Now it has been given in common base mode, current gain is 0.96. in common base mode we can write IC by IE, the current through collector to current through emitter is 0.96, and we have to find finally IB. So what we will do, since we have collector current, we will try to write IE also in terms of IC. So we can write IE as IB plus IC 0.96. Now we have to solve this equation. For solving this, IC equal to 0.96 IB plus 0.96 IC. So if we solve it further, we can go we can get 0.04 IC equal to 0.96 IB. And IB is IC by 24, and the value of IC we had already calculated now, that was 1 milliampere. So finally we are going to get IB as 1 by 24 milliampere, and that is option D. Come to question number 23. In this question we have been given logic gates and connected like this. First gate is NAND gate, second one is also NAND gate, and what will be the equivalent of these two gates, we have to find that. So we can see that the second gate, both inputs are same, and finally it is not here, so it can be replaced by a NOT gate. NOT and NOT will nullify each other, and finally we will get only AND gate. So our answer will be AND gate. The same thing we could have also written as X and Y, the inputs are X and Y, X and Y, then it becomes NAND. Now both of these two are used for NAND gate further. Now we can resolve it
as x dot y. Since these two are same, we can directly write like this, one bar or this first one and second bar is here, and these two will cancel, finally we will get x dot y. So our option will be AND gate, that is option D. Come to question number 24. In this question we have been given three numbers and we have to write the number of significant figures in these numbers. So first number is, we are having total 5 digits, since all non-zero digits are significant and zeros between them is also significant. So total 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. In second number, the zeros on the left side will be considered insignificant. Only significant is the non-zero number 4. So the number of significant figures here is 1. In third number, there are only 2 numbers and both are non-zero. So number of significant figures here will be 2. So that is option B. Come to next question, 25. This question is about the magnetic properties of material. If a needle if three needles N1, N2 and N3 are having their magnetic properties as ferromagnetic, paramagnetic and diamagnetic respectively, if they are brought near a magnetic field or near a magnet, what will be impact on this? Ferromagnetic materials are strongly attracted by the magnet or magnetic field. So ferromagnetic will be strongly attracted. Paramagnetic materials are attracted, but they are weakly attracted, and diamagnetic are repelled from magnetic field. So this is strongly attracted, N2 is weakly attracted and N3 is weakly repelled. So our answer will be option B. Okay, come to question number 26. This question is about the statement and assertion reason question. There are two statements given and the statements are, if there is two circular wires placed in a plane, they are in same plane, coplanar, and their radius are different. In that case, the coefficient of mutual induction will be maximum. This is the first statement. So first statement is correct. In this case, we get the coefficient of mutual induction maximum. Now come to second statement. In second statement, it is said for the same configuration, means two rings in same plane, coplanar and different radii, the flux linkage by one of the ring due to current through second is maximum. So second statement is also correct. We can see how it is correct. If we pass a current here, the direction of magnetic field is into the plane. Now second ring is coplanar, so flux is passing through the second ring also. Now consider the different orientations. If the inner ring is rotated by some angle, if inner ring is suppose rotated, and now it is, the plane of inner ring is perpendicular to the plane of first ring. In this case, we can see there is no flux which is crossing through the area of inner ring. So flux linkage has decreased in this case. Flux linkage is maximum when they are coplanar. And if they are coplanar, mutual induction will also be maximum, because flux linkage and mutual induction are related by this. Flux linkage and mutual induction are related by this. So we can write that M, if M is more and phi is more, these two statements are saying this. And second statement is also giving the correct explanation. So we will write option A. Okay, come to the next question. Question number 27. In this question, we have been given two statements regarding the
motion of a charged particle in electric and magnetic field. First statement is charged particle cannot be in rest in a region containing only electric and magnetic field. So first we will see that if a charged particle is in electric field, it will experience a force Q into E. It will experience a force, electric force Q into E, and magnetic force Q V into B. So for getting magnetic force, we need to have velocity of particle as well, but it is given particle at rest. So there will be no magnetic field, there will be no magnetic force on the particle at rest. So only electric force, and only one force is there, so that will accelerate the particle. Particle cannot remain in rest. So this statement is correct. Come to the second statement. Second statement says particle is released at rest, only then it will remain at rest, balancing electric and magnetic force. So this statement is wrong, because in this case it is written particle, if particle is released at rest, only then it will remain at rest, which is not correct. We can see here it will get accelerated. So this statement is wrong, and hence our option will be answer C. Okay, come to question number 28. In this question, first statement is written, disc rolling without slipping on horizontal surface, acceleration of lowest point of disc is 0. So let us draw a disc here which is undergoing pure rolling. It is saying that the lowest point is having 0 acceleration, but it is not correct, because lowest point is undergoing a circular motion, and so it will have a centripetal acceleration towards the center. Because it is moving in circle, it will have a centripetal acceleration. Come to second statement, for pure rolling on horizontal surface, lowest point velocity is always 0. For pure rolling, the velocity of this point is always 0. This statement is correct, because the point here is in contact with ground, and since there is no sliding between these two, the point here will remain static. So this statement is wrong and this is right. So we can write the option D as our answer. Okay, come to the next question, question number 29. This question is about LCR circuit. In LCR circuit, first statement says that average power consumed in a resistance is equal to total power consumed in the circuit. So this statement is correct. And second statement says that power consumed in inductor and power consumed in capacitor is 0. The average power in inductor and average power in capacitor is 0. So this is also correct. That we can see how it is like this, because in case of LCR circuit, from inductor component, the current and voltage through it have a phase difference of pi by 2, which gives cos pi by 2, the power factor, equal to 0. Similarly, here also pi by 2 is the phase difference between current and voltage, and hence power factor we get as cos pi by 2, which is 0. So both of this will give 0 average power in LCR circuit, but resistance is the only segment of LCR circuit which gives power. So total power is equal, and we can see here that both statements are correct, and second one is giving the explanation of the first statement. So we can write our option as A. Okay, come to the next question, question number 30. In this question, statement 1 is saying that for helium and oxygen gas of equal moles, heat supplied to them is same at constant volume. Then rise in temperature of helium is greater than rise in temperature of oxygen. So let us check this statement. Since Q equal to n Cv delta T at constant value, we can write like this. So delta T will be Q by n Cv. And we can check for helium and oxygen. For helium, it will be Q by n. Helium is a monatomic gas, so Cv will be 3 by 2R. So we can write 2Q by 3NR. Similarly, for oxygen, we can write N and Cv. So oxygen is a diatomic molecule. For diatomic molecule, Cv is 5 by 2R. So we can write 2Q by 5NR. So we can see that rise in temperature of helium is more. So this statement is correct. Now come to the second statement. Second statement says molecular weight of oxygen is greater than molecular weight of helium. Molecular weight of oxygen is greater than molecular weight of helium. So that is also correct. Molecular is a heavy molecule and helium is light molecule. This one is also correct. But the second statement is not the correct explanation of first one. We can see that temperature change has nothing to do with the molecular weight. It is coming due to the specific heat at constant volume. These are different for these two molecules. That's why we are getting different temperature rise. So these two are not related. So our answer will be option B.